It is.
Is it distracting?
No, it's making sure like I'm in the frame and I'm not like,
hi everyone!
Yes. Phantom.
Okay, so today, we haven't done a lecture in a little while. We've done a lot of workshops the last few weeks and such, and we did the AlphaGo stuff, which was amazing, and we've been thoroughly enjoying those games. But today I thought we'd go back to a more traditional lecture and talk about a specific player, Rui Naiwei, which I cannot pronounce Chinese very well, so that's my best. Are you Chinese?
Yeah, I don't speak Mandarin very well.
All right. You're Chinese.
Actually speaks Mandarin.
I speak Mandarin.
Yeah? Well, how would you pronounce it? Do you have a better pronunciation than
it
I do?
It would be Rui Naiwei. It would be Rui
Naiwei. Rui Naiwei?
Yeah, there we go.
All right.
Go ahead.
We'll give myself a D minus.
Wei Qi.
Yeah, Wei Qi. Well, anyway, this player, I'm going to say Rui, because that's what I do. She is generally considered to be the strongest female Go player ever, which is pretty awesome. She was born in China, became a pro in the early 1980s, and sort of, you know, did okay, played for the Chinese national team, was winning lots of games. Really nice. She actually moved to the U.S. for a very short time. She actually did a whole bunch of great things for American Go. She helped support the U.S. Go Congresses. She actually ended up teaching quite a few of the U.S., you know, really strong players. And soon after that, though, the Korean Baduk Association sort of courted her to come to Korea. And so she got married to actually another Nine Don Go player. And they basically moved to Korea in the 90s. And I think it was 19, so she's, and when she first started moving there, or moved there, they were kind of skeptical as to what to do with her because she's a Chinese professional who's trying to play in the Korean tournaments and things, and they don't really like that. She actually spent some time in Japan, basically with the same situation where, you know, she's a Chinese professional, but not really welcomed. There's some parallels with Go Sagan. Go Sagan sort of went through the same thing, right, where, you know, Chinese, Taiwanese player moved to Japan and they didn't know what to do with him. So she kind of went through the same kind of thing, but eventually, basically through Cho Hun Hyun, who's one of the strongest Korean pros, she gradually gained not temporary professional status, but like an honorary Korean professional status, and they welcomed her in those tournaments. And in 1999, she actually beat Cho Hun Hyun in the first major title tournament ever to be won by a woman. So I mean, good for him. Welcomes her to his country, brings her to his association, and knocks him out of the title game. Right, shake fist. But anyway, so you know, she's played a lot of these strong tournaments. She's done very, very well. Many of the you know, women professional players all look to her as a role model. Like, and they take her very, very seriously. And that's from all countries. That's not just China or Korea or, you know, or even just Japan. They all sort of look at, you know, Rui Naiwei. No, still bad pronunciation, as being the sort of leader in the Go world for women in particular. But, you know, again, she's hanging with the boys, too. I mean, she's actually, you know, cover your ears, kicking a lot of ass. You know, this is... she actually had quite a reputation as being a nine-don killer. She took down a lot of the strongest, you know, male players she faced against. In the last few years, she hasn't been playing quite as high as a competitive level. But, you know, today I want to look actually at a game when she... This is actually a game from 2000. This is actually the year after she won that first major men's title. And she played against a very famous player, Li Chang-ho, who we've covered before in this class, right? And Li Chang-ho really was, like, the number one Go player in the world for basically over 10 years. And I thought we'd start with that. Her style is kind of aggressive. I mean, it's... It's brutally aggressive at times. We're not necessarily going to see that in this game. But she earned the nickname in Korea, the Iron Lady, of just being like, oh, you're going to move there? I'm just going to like just be very stubborn and we're just going to fight for the rest of the game. A lot of her games end in like huge board capturing races. You know, she very like I was just looking through some of her game records and just looking at the number of games that actually go to final scoring, and it's so few. It's just like every game just someone has to resign because someone loses something. So, you guys want to see a game?
Cool.
Yes, please.
Cool? All right. Rui Naiwei is black in this game. Li Chang Ho is white. And so far, normal. We'd almost say this is like a mini Chinese type formation today, but Li Chang Ho immediately disrupts this. And this is again before even the mini Chinese was like a thing, right? They still play this type of opening. Usually looking to play orthodox. And black does not respond, takes the open corner. So pretty normal. White over here needs a follow-up move. If white just plays this, this would be like a standard follow-up. This is not the game. Like this would be fine. But white has one big development on one side of the board, so maybe there's a lack of a sense of a global ability. So white doesn't want to play this, even though it's a nice development. And white comes there. Actually pincer this stone, put some pressure. Comes out, very natural. And then Li Chang Ho style. Li Chang Ho, if you guys remember from our previous classes, really, really just like proper patient kind of style in the opening. He's going to beat you in the mid game and the end game. Right? He's basically just trying to get through the opening as quickly as possible. It's like, people, we don't understand the opening. You know, humans, like, we can't measure all the possibilities. So just get through it and get to the fun stuff. And then he will beat you in that middle game through attacking, and that end game through his just meticulously perfect end game. So, over here, black goes this way. Do you guys like this way or this way? What would you play if you want to approach that corner? I would like to play this way too.
Me too.
Yeah. This just feels natural. You know, expanding from the bigger side of the board where you have 4-4 stones. This is kind of like, I mean, it's a, like, there's nothing wrong with this move, but it's like it feels like we're getting a little bit tense. Like, wait, oh, you want this? No, you can't have this. You know, we're gonna fight over this. So white plays here. Natural move. Black. Again, this is offering a fight, but there's actually a joseki that they play out that settles immediately. So this is joseki. Have you guys seen this joseki before? No? Kind of? Maybe? It's a distinct possibility in your short lives. So what does black get in this joseki?
Corner.
Good.
Side.
A little bit aside, we actually have a fourth line stone on the side too, so there's future development up here. What does white get?
Lower side.
Lower side. Oh, I messed up the order already. I shouldn't be doing this entirely from memory. After this, black makes one more exchange, sorry. I always do that.
Yeah, white definitely
lower
side.
Yeah, this stone helps this. But there's one nice thing about this variation for black, is all of white's development is already kind of low. It's already kind of third line, and even has a defect too. So even though black, this corner is basically not black at all, white doesn't have very many points over here. So, is it not white's turn? Black played here last, yes?
Yeah.
So even though black has the corner and has development, there's a weakness. So white aims for it. This is how you aim for that type of weakness. And these two stones have a little bit of agi, which white will put into motion right now. Since white's trying to attack black's weakness, we're going to use some of our free stuff just to get a little bit stronger. So black descends. White says, no, those are dead. Black goes, I know. But if I extend there, I can get this atari for free. And later on, the other benefit of extending is also this move might be sente later. So even though these two stones are going to die, right, they still might be worth free stuff. And then finally, black comes back and defends that weakness there. All right, so in this game, right, we have a very strong white group right here, right, because these two stones are dead. We have two white stones. Again, there's a defect, but they have friends, and it's very flexible. So this is not really a problem. This is a base. We have two stone extension, so white solid here. Black has a corner that's very undefined. Hard to know who's going to get these points. And then we have one little white stone over here. So where do you think Li Cheng Ho plays?
Attack the undefined group.
Attack this one? How do you attack it?
I don't know.
Okay. It's hard to attack right now, actually. Even though white's basically strong enough all over the place, there is still a little bit of this ladder situation. For instance, let me just put this down there. You know, what happens if, let's say, black plays there? This can get actually quite complicated, because there is this ladder. But then white can also fight against the ladder. So, who knows? Like, there can be chaos. This is not the game. Not the game. But there are different things, different shapes that can come out where black can fight, black can settle, black can do all sorts of things, and so can white for that matter. It's very flexible for both sides. So where's the interesting part of the board? This is interesting?
No.
Why is this interesting, Maya? What do you think? Are dead stones interesting? Weak stones are interesting. So where is there weak stones or weak stone?
White stone.
Yeah, this one right here, right? So we need to do something about this stone. Right, again, Li Cheng Ho just wants to get to the middle game, right? He's not interested in running around weak groups in the opening. This is not his style. It's not what he's really good at. This is like Lee Sedol style, right? It would be to make a bunch of weak stones in the opening and just figure it out later, you know?
Space extension.
So this would be really conservative, right? Li Cheng Ho at some point has to ask for a little bit more, otherwise it's going to fall too far behind. If he just goes around the board and makes, you know, 4-point group, 4-point group, 4-point group, 4-point group, that's 16 points. You can't win with 16 points. So at some point we have to play something more efficient. One other nice thing, like this is a natural move to approach the corner. Also, do you notice the spacing here? Five, we like five spaces, right? That's good. If you're gonna make a far space jump, like an extension, that's a good spacing. Okay, so what do you think Ri Nawe does here?
Pincer.
Absolutely, I like your enthusiasm. Where?
H3.
So this pincer.
Maybe J3.
H4.
Or this one. Or this one. Any other options? This one? Or this one?
So there's six possible.
There's also this one too, right? So there's one, she definitely pincers, right? You should, and I want you to all feel this in your go hearts, okay? Like, you have to pincer here. Even though white made a very nice five space extension, right? That's optimal spacing to, you know, most efficient spacing between stones. Why do we have to pincer here? Like, why do we have to do it in our heart? Otherwise, we're not playing go.
Because then you're letting white get the whole side, right?
Yeah, if we let white, you know, play another move in here, that feels bad. But why does it feel so bad?
You're strong on those sides.
Yeah, we have a wall here, right? We even exchange extra free stuff to get more stones over here. We're very strong. And we also played the 4-4. We want the outside when we play the 4-4. Right? So black is like saying, this is kind of like mine. It's not white's. If white was to make this shape over here, maybe before, well, at some point, right? Black would be more fine with this in this case, right? If white already had all these stones here. Because black has, you know, really big potential with this wall, we have to fight. We're not going to play this. Right? This is just, this wall is doing nothing now. Very difficult. So we must fight. So Ri Nawe plays this one. And I'd be very, in my own game, I'd be tempted to play this one. Like it just feels balanced, but maybe it's too symmetrical and white can squirm with both of these, I don't know. But at this point, white plays a really surprising move. It's not a move I would have expected, but maybe I should have. Maybe that's why I'm not a strong go player. Do you want to guess how white handles this? What would you naturally play? What would you want to play?
Out.
Yeah, you'd say, okay, you put a stone in between two of my stones, now we fight, right? I jump out, and now we're going to get into this running fight. This is not what Li Chang Hao plays.
Corner.
This would also be natural, right? Say, I'm just going to give up that stone. I'm just going to take all these points over here and give up that one. Li Chang Hao is also not interested in that.
Double approach.
Double approach. Change direction. Say, I'm really not interested in this stone. I really want this. Li Chang Hao is not interested in that.
Attach underneath.
Which way?
The middle, that stone.
Yes, nine down professional. There you go. This is what Li Chang Hao plays. And this is a move that's not wouldn't be on my radar normally. It seems really submissive. Right? We already crawled on the third line over here. Third line over here. We took the two stones over here with basically third line extension. And again, we have two third line stones and we're going to play more third line. This is like Li Chang Hao style. Right? I mean, just play safe, build bases everywhere, invade and attack later. So that's what he does. Okay. All right. Now you are Ri Na Wei. So what do you do? How do you deal with this?
You have to play J3.
You have to play J3. You have to play it.
Yeah.
She doesn't play it. It feels like you have to play it, right? It's like, hey, this was ours, right? Yeah. White's being kind of a poo-poo head, comes in here, tries to live with like two, you know, turds. So we attack. White says, please, please, please. I just want to connect on the third line. It feels like you have to say no, right?
Yeah.
She totally doesn't say that. So what are your other options?
Jump in the middle.
Jump in the middle again, like here? So this would be something to consider, but the problem is that now this stone's really weak. And because we already have a wall here, white could probably give this up and get benefit on the outside.
Build a wall and take the top
side? There you go. We have a wall over here. Let's say, you know what? This wall, all right, you that's right, Li Chang Hao, you've nullified this wall. I'm just going to build another wall, a bigger wall, a grander wall, a Donald Trump-sized wall. Best wall ever.
He wasn't born yet, was he?
When this game happened?
Yeah, he hadn't been cloned yet. He hadn't come out of there.
Oh, yeah. He hasn't done a lot of things yet. He might have been bankrupt when this game was going on.
Yes, one of the times.
So. Yeah. So, white, it's like, okay.
Great,
sure. Oops. You see this wall here?
It's big,
all right. White plays here. That was my topical reference for the day, by the way. In five videos, you know, no one's gonna get this reference. Unless Donald Trump wins somehow. All right, so here? Now we have to start this fight. So I said, right, Ri Na Wei does not take any crap. Not interested in taking crap. This is kind of crap. So let's start this fight. And first of all, fix the corner. All right, you're white. What do you do?
Kill those three steps.
How?
G6 with J4.
This move is important first. This move is basically sente for both players. Right? If you play over here, black is going to descend and then threaten to kill these three. This is a very, very important move. This also actually helps link up to this stone too, so we don't have to worry about black cutting here later. Say.
Now black has to jump
this way. Next white move. How do we continue? It's the fight. It's a chance to work on your nine don fighting skills. You can fight the pro here. What's weak? What's white's weakest group?
The two.
These two. What's black's weakest group?
Three and one.
And
these things, right? So if we have the two weakest groups on the board are right next to each other, you better bet your lucky socks. The move is going to be somewhere over here. So what do you want to play?
F7?
Aggressive. What? I'm just a little bit curious. What happens if black does this?
Oh yeah, that sounds bad.
That sounds bad.
Maybe like E7.
Maybe E7? How about we try to lean on something strong? Something that's already strong, maybe we'll lean on something to try to get shape.
So like just...
D5?
Yeah, D5.
Yeah, D5. It also prevents the corner from getting really big, because if we just run this way, and let's say it turns out that black can get strong enough here without needing another move, this has the potential to get really, really big. So white first place here. Black Hanes. Again, liberties are important, right? White just gained a liberty.
Yeah.
In a fight, we don't like it when our opponent has more liberties. Take it away. White plays here. Again, this helps get the stones out, and again, it helps surround the corner. But black has an idea to play this move. Is this dangerous?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not really. Black is in no danger whatsoever. Why is black in, why can black do this without any sort of fear? This looks really aggressive, right? Look at these cuts. Yeah, we still have a liberty problem, right? Black could still cut here. So we have no fear. So white makes an exchange. And comes out again.
I see.
Keep the attack going. And now we're taking our weak stones, right? This move actually makes them quite a bit stronger. Puts another friend in the neighborhood. White has no choice but to fix. Super sad.
Why not E6 though?
Yeah, so why not E6? This move looks like it actually helps this cut.
Yeah.
So why not this?
Is it afraid of B7 that black can extend there?
D7?
B?
Oh,
B7? Oh yeah, black can totally extend there. This move might actually lose liberties for white.
Yeah.
Because right now, right, this is not a liberty. Right, because if black gets these two, white has to fill this in anyway. So if black gets this move, white really only has 4 liberties. If we play this move, we still have the same, I guess we still have 4 liberties, but...
Well, black can throw plus. in if white has...
Oh yeah, and there's also the throw in...
Yeah, yeah, it's really ugly.
If the other problem is, if we play this thinking we're going to be able to cut here later, what happens if black, you know, just even plays this? Right, now there's no cut here. And this... not a lot of liberties, right? It immediately collapses. It's one of these shapes that... If you play this move, it's really hard to expose this, even with a stone here, because you don't have that many liberties. So white just plays there. Whoops. Turn my iPad back on. Haven't used it in so long. For white connects, black plays here now. And because, again, partially because white played this one, white can hane here. White has enough liberties to do this.
Wait, even with... Yeah, even this white can still play Hane.
I'm not 100% sure if white gets sealed in here, though. Totally can. Alright.
Yeah.
But, you know, maybe black gets a... I don't know. Again, later. It works right now for white. It works locally for white.
Okay.
You're right. I don't know. I'd be. This just looks so scary, though.
It is scary.
Okay. So after here, black just takes a stone. White has to make some sort of shape. This is a pretty big corner for black. You know how many points that is?
10.
Oh, it's bigger than 10.
14.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably closer to about 14. Probably, I would conservatively say probably 12 or 13. Could be more, again, depending on the end game. But even if we just imagine walls here, right, we can see clearly 11 points, 12, 13, and 14 points, just all there, assuming that white gets an Atari. All right, so how strong is this white group?
Doesn't have eyes.
So, how do we keep the pressure on? How do we attack?
From the other side.
C12. C11 or C12? How about D12? You know, I know you guys know Takamiya Masaki, right? Nine-Dan Cosmic Ghost style. You find a lot of Rui Naiwe's games also, she thinks fourth line, thinks big, thinks middle. In a lot of these games, which is how she gets into like these giant capturing races. Because she's like, I own the middle, I can go fight wherever I want. I don't need eyes, I just need liberties. I just runs the middle. So that's where my stones are. So again, she's gonna build, you know, it's not really clear what's out here yet, but again, attack high. This would be very territorial. This would be very like concerned with shape and territory. Again, that's not really her thing. She's focused on the global more often than not. All right, so Li Chengho is still like, this group sucks. We need to counterattack somehow, right? We still have two weak groups over here. This move might, you know, maybe you could even say he was thinking maybe this is the wrong direction, or if it is the right direction, that's his opportunity to counterattack. So black needs to play some moves in order to get this group to a little bit safer. When white plays this, what is that move doing? This looks like a weird move to play right now, right?
Yeah.
Wouldn't you want to like try something like this?
Yeah.
So what is this move doing?
Threatening a P1 peep.
P2?
P2.
Yeah. This is, these stones actually don't have eyes yet. So this really hurts this black group. And if black takes the time to respond this way, right, this stone is useful actually for these cuts in this territory. But in this case, black's not going to respond. Black's like, we'll deal with that later. Totally not important right now. Instead, black will play these. This is all just exchanges just to get an extra free move. Let's increase the sacrifice. Again, these three white stones. Help. This is all good timing. This is the time you want to do this right now because, again, this black group is weak. So anything you do, anything that you threaten is good, that's going to make this group stronger, white's going to respond to. Whereas later on, this is just purely endgame, right? White might not care about these four stones later. White might find a bigger move. So this is good timing. Okay, so basically black gets that for free. So remember our 14-point corner? It's looking like it might even be 15 points. And we did that all on Sente, like a pretty solid 15. That's quite a bit. And now we need one more move to help this group, and again, keep the pressure on this group. All right, what do you do as white? Li Chengho time. Time to play like a nine-don professional.
Invade the D.
Invade where?
Like D14.
D14 here?
Yeah.
Oh man, that's crazy. you're saying this is thickness? We can now use it to attack this stone?
Or maybe exchange for an entire corner.
Give all this up for this. That's not a good idea. we need to get this stronger first.
Just
right?
Capture that one black stone?
Right here? Cut this way?
Yeah.
We can, but it feels really slow.
It does.
Possible, but feels really slow. So.
Why wouldn't you play on something like C11?
C.
Like here?
Yeah.
You, sir, are a 9-down professional. This is what Li Chang Ho plays. Yeah, he's just trying to settle, right? He just wants to make his group stronger so we can go and start doing Li Chang Ho stuff. But Rui Nawei is not interested in him doing Li Chang Ho stuff.
Yeah.
Like, oh, you want the side? You can have the side. I get the middle. Right? She's playing her game, he's playing his. So it goes like this. If someone did this to you, wouldn't you normally play there, right? It seems so big.
Yeah.
And she's just not interested in it. She doesn't care. Totally fine. And then she plays there. Again, just exposing weaknesses in here. Remember, there's actually still... This move as well is really annoying, too. So there's actually lots of Aji in here. So the shape is very, very... delicate for white, so white has to play another slow move like this. And now she'll say, okay, I come back. So at this moment, though, this is not guaranteed 2 eyes. That's the other thing. Like, it's still not guaranteed 2 eyes. But it has at least 1 eye, we know that, and it takes black a lot of effort to poke out both eyes. So now we can go to try to do Li Chang Ho stuff, try to unseat some groups, start like a real middle game that's more aggressive for white. All right, what do you think black does here? Does black connect? Or give up the entire corner? Yeah, connecting is really big. It's really big. But this is terrible shape, right? Well, how many eyes does black have here?
One-ish.
Black should be able to get one. I think it would take white 2 moves in order to prevent 0 eyes. So that does remove black's eyes down to 1, and black does still have to work for it, technically. There's still this little connection problem here between this weak group and this weak group. So I can start to see that, you know, maybe there are some problems here with white. But white plays here first. And to me, this move feels a little bit weak on the weak side. So let's black just give up a stone. And I don't know if it was a mistake or not. I mean, Li Chang Ho is obviously much, much stronger than I am. But, you know, after these exchanges, black's like, I have enough stuff here. I'm totally fine. So I don't know if, I mean, this one stone is really big, right? Because this actually turns into pretty serious points now. The Aji from these stones is significantly lessened. There's still weaknesses here, right? It still doesn't fix anything. But, you know, black's like, I've got enough stuff to connect up and make everything live. How about the size of this?
Maybe.
Maybe really big. So normally white can invade in here at this time. But again, because this group doesn't have guaranteed 2 eyes yet, we're playing whole place here. And now white basically has 2 eyes, and black can annoy white, but we can't have the dream of killing this whole thing after this move. So again, Li Chang Ho plays this very safe move. Makes this exchange, again, helps the center a little bit. Also actually potentially activates that stone later if we care about it. But again, black's just trying to take this now. White doesn't like it when black takes the corner. Nope, we're done up here. That's fine. Again, we care about the middle. Go back to our original plan. And you can actually see that even though there's defects here for black, you know, here, you know, in here, there is starting to be a lot of stuff in the middle. And if we look at the territory, right, assuming that white can link up the stone or live here, there's actually not that much black territory here. There is a lot of black territory here. There's not that much black territory here. There's not that much black territory here either. There's really not that much black territory. But, you know, white doesn't have a lot either. And so right now, the biggest part of the board, at least for both players, right, this isn't that big. this could get bigger. But after that, like, this is, you know, 5 points, 7 points, 8 points, 4 or 5 points. I mean, there's nothing big. So the middle actually starts growing really large by comparison, because they've destroyed each other's territories so much. And usually that's like Li Cheng Ho style, right? You know, just constantly, you know, nicking each other's territories back and forth. Like, that's very like Li Cheng Ho's type of game. But after this, it is White's move. And so now we have to attack. Because if Black has all this stuff in the middle, that's the biggest area. We have to combat it. What do you think Black plays here? Do we save the stone? Why would this be a bad idea?
Because Black wants the middle.
Well, not only does Black want the middle, though, there's actually some issues with Aji, if White can split here. And we have a weak group here and a weak group here. There's also this type of Atari, Atari, and cut sequence as well. There's actually a lot of different ways for White to use this one stone and these two weaknesses. So, if White cuts here, you know, the move Black might think about, this is not what Black played, but Black might think about here, to say, you know, let's just give up a stone, and then try to link everything together. Give up a little bit to stay safe from the outside, to keep that center. Like I said, Black doesn't play this either. The problem with this type of sequence is that there's still Aji. There's still all these cuts. So how about first we ask White if we can just live with one of these two weak groups? Just say, hey dude, can I just kill a stone and just live in the corner? And White says yes. Because now White has a fish to go after. So now Black is stuck sort of having to defend this fish a little bit, this giant whale of a group that almost has eyes, but not quite two of them guaranteed yet. So White will poke here. And again, as long as there's enough space to make two eyes, and after this move there is, again, Black's is happy to take the outside. Black doesn't care about the cut. Okay, at this point, White has made some inroads here. Still not 100% super safe here. There's still Aji for White to exploit. But now White wants some points, so White pushes up here. Exchange this for this. And we're just taking points here. White comes back here to eat the corner. And again, you start to see this weakness start to potentially be a problem. Let me just go forward a few moves. Nope, went far too far. White just actually just connects here. This type of connection. Have you guys seen this type of connection before? This looks like Atari, right? Oh, White can connect there. Oh, actually, before this, though, White actually does take it. Sorry. In response to here, I missed the Atari here. White should take this first, because that's free. This is free. And then plays here. And then makes a connection this way. Right? And if Black takes these two, White just takes back and everything's connected, right? This corner is not Black. So, I mean, this is a pretty big loss in terms of, I mean, we already thought these points wouldn't be Black anyway, but if Black ever thought that they would be, this is a pretty huge loss. What does Black get in exchange, though?
More in the middle,
it has a pretty significant defect, though. So, should we fix the defect right now?
Yeah.
Let's try to fix it from afar. If we can fix it by attacking, if we can seal this White group in, if White tries to poke through and cut here, we can just actually fight with these stones out and maybe capture everything that White cuts here. So because of that, White plays a little bit more slowly. says, okay, you really have a defect here. I'm in over here. I can fight here too. Your wall is stupid. Fix your wall. Fix your wall. Fix your wall. I'm going to eat all these stones. It's all white territory. Fix your wall. Fix your wall. No. So what does this stone do?
Could destroy the white territory.
We're going to destroy your territory, right? I don't care about you. You can capture my forest stones. We're going to destroy all your territory. It has another effect. What's the other effect?
Splits the two acres.
Yeah, and again, even though this looks like it's completely alive, this is only a false eye here. If we get an Atari. And this group definitely doesn't have eyes yet. In fact, it still has a defect. And maybe, hey, there's two weak-ish white, I mean, these aren't inherently, you know, killable white stones, but they're kind of weakish. So maybe we start running some of these weak groups together and we play in between them and we kill something. Maybe. Iron Lady style. Li Chengho is kind of prepared for this, though. Right, okay, you're going to go that deep? Good. Good for you. I'm going to run these out, which is actually going to potentially put more pressure on your corner, help these two stones over here, and directly threaten to capture this stone. Like all in a day's work. We now takes another moment to, again, completely barricade the two white stones. And at this point, if black doesn't do something, these two stones can be killed at this point, right? Once this connection is more or less broken. So Li Chengho has to make a couple exchanges. Make sure I get the right ones. Okay, so now white's alive. This is actually sizable points, too. This is almost 10 points. And black's going to peep here, which is... It basically prevents white from pushing and cutting here to capture eye shape, to get eye shape. So again, trying to keep this stone useful. Often, if you have a weak stone in here, you think, I need to poke this way to get the stone out. But again, she also wants to make sure when she gets the stone out, if she can get the stone out, white is still under attack. So you have to poke the shape this way so white doesn't get strong. So black plays this terrible looking move. This is like a 20Q move. Why is this normally a terrible idea?
Attach a weak stone?
Yeah, attaching to a weak stone inside your territory, you're just giving it free stuff. It can run over. And furthermore, it actually doesn't fix this cut 100%. It fixes it only like 30%. So... Well, what would you play instead?
One move
above. Play here?
Oh, no, but it can still win.
You can still cut,
though. Yeah, there's still... There's still.
The knight's move.
Here?
Yeah, here. There. Yeah.
This looks better, but there's still a problem here now, because, again, black is strong.
That group is still...
You know, and even if we just play the most horrid-looking shapes ever, right, this would be a normal sort of, like... get out kind of sequence. You know, white doesn't really have another good follow-up here. Maybe that's the best, but there's just too many pokes. So, you know, basically white is trying to avoid just playing this. This would be really submissive, right? Saying, yes, you were never my point. You were right, I was wrong. I never actually had that. And, you know, maybe if, you know, white, even if white, doesn't completely cleanly kill this stone, maybe by provoking a fight over here, maybe white can poke through here or take advantage of something else if black makes white really strong by squirming this one stone around. But black, you know, goes into the key point, right? Threatens to connect that way. Hana is the weak stone, the weak white stone. White just has to connect. And black just takes another Atari. Again, all the moves here are just 20Q. We're just playing a 20Q game. And black goes in deeper. Does white have eyes yet here?
It could have one.
And in fact, white will make exchange and then take one eye right now. Black takes this Aji. White takes Atari again to start to make the second eye down here. And then has to come back and make that eye. And black makes that move, which is actually quite large. Because not only does it capture this one stone, it threatens to do this, right? And give white no eyes. Or one eye again. This one eye. So white has to respond again. And black can play there. White can take free stuff. Black just connects. And at this point, white's looking at these two groups and going, can they live? Are they alive? Can white live with both of those? This is like, you know, super hard go question, right? This is what players think about for, you know, 30 minutes on a single move in a go tournament kind of game, right? So they have to read all the variations. Black can still play here to take this eye away, right?
Yeah.
But if black does
does
that inherently live?
Goes this? No, it's not. Oh, it might connect the other way.
It could connect here and make co. There's a co here, right? So if black does this, there's this kind of thing for co. Right? You could say, well, black can just not play co, but if you do that, then white's just connected.
Yeah.
Right, so there is this type of sequence. What if black does this? Oh, this is good.
So.
This is actually still co. And furthermore, can white make an eye over here? What if white maybe starts right here? I mean, there is a defect here, right? There's a hane and a defect here. White does have resources to take advantage of. And how about this group? If we assume that this group is at least co, but probably because it's a co, you know, all these things over here threaten to make eyes, it's basically alive. How does this group make two eyes? We can just play there, right? And that's basically sente, because black has to play there. And, you know, if black takes this, you know, we can just make another eye there. Right? So white is totally 100% fine with both of these groups. So Li Chengho says, okay, I'm totally fine. We're all good. You pay now. Remember this? Like, even though, you know, got reduced here, this would actually be more points. In the end, if white gets to capture all this. But game's not over yet. Rui Naue plays here. Remember how I said white could probably make an eye here? After this move, it's not so clear. And furthermore, you know, black, this you know, first of all, helps this weak group. It can help this weak group, right? This is actually a really useful stone for the health of the rest of the board. It also gives another place for these four stones to potentially run. And if black gets another move over here, we might be able to turn these into points, or these into points. You know, there's things here that are still big in the middle, right? Black can still make 6, 7, 8, 9 points in any one of these areas. So, you know, white's like, all right, game, I win. But they go to this thing. And instead of taking the code directly, what do we place here? Sorry, just connects. Place here. This is just straight up co for life. So when black takes here, right, this is not an eye yet. If white makes this an eye, black throws in there. If white throws in there, or plays there, black throws in there. So actually this point, this co makes an eye. You need that co to make that into an eye shape. But it's co, right? Co's totally fine. We can just threaten to live any number of times. So we're totally 100% fine. Right? You want to win the co? Fine, I eat this stone. Okay, what happens if we play a threat like this? That's kind of a threat, isn't it? So White says, okay, well, we'll play our little co game. I read this all out. I'm Li Changhao, I know what I'm doing. I've played this game before. Notice they're not even taking the co right now. They're just playing out this group. It almost looks like they're burning co threats, except this happens. And, you know, this is sort of like a one-step co here for now the life of this group. And actually, it's actually worse than that because black has a... Oh, no, it's not worse than that because white black can't quite connect yet.
But. Black can just connect from T5.
Hmm? T5. Oh, there's the connection. Thank you. There it is. Yeah, yeah. So white plays here. Again, there's actually this cut.
Okay.
Yeah. Right? So if black takes this, white can cut here and then...
A bigger co.
Yeah. Threaten everything. But black says that's fine. Totally fine. White threatens to capture. And this is just Iron Lady move. This looks so bad for white, but she makes this work. Like, it looks like, you know, like it just gives white all these free stuff, all the free moves everywhere. But they play this out a little bit. But what she's looking for is to do this, or Li Changhao is looking for is to do this. Yeah. But in doing so, right, Li Changhao then loses this point. So instead of this being a one-step ko here for this eye, it's now a direct ko for that eye.
Yeah.
Wait, one second. Could you explain again why the move on N12 is a good move? You said it was an Iron Lady move, you know?
Yeah.
Why does that one...
So I call it an Iron Lady move because this is a move that's normally not good.
Yeah.
Like, it's normally a dark
light.
So why is it good here? The white group basically is ko for life, but only if white can't make more threats here.
Okay.
Okay? So what black is sort of doing is sort of preemptively starting to take away these threats in like the most pig-headed way possible. Mm-hmm. Like just, we're just preventing any eye space here, period, right? So you have fewer threats. And if you do just want to go down here and live, well, hey, maybe I can link up or do something like this where I actually end up capturing all this too. Right, you're actually giving your opponent a choice. Hey, you can just go live, you know, just fight this ko. I'll take two moves here and bam, I'll just make 20 points in the middle. You know, and those four stones, not a big deal anymore. But after all this, here, white sort of lets this fight spill over into this group just a little bit. You know, because of this pig-headedness. Right?
Wasn't that the reason for black's moves anyway, was to be able to make that connection at the bottom?
Yes, absolutely. You know, when black plays this diagonal down here?
No, not the diagonal.
Oh, which?
All the four stones that black just played along the end of the line.
Yes?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that was to force the connection to kill the white stones on the bottom left.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. I mean, what basically, this is you're going to now, you know, move that group out.
Yeah.
And in doing so, it's going to spoil into this group. And this is a very, very common go strategy, right? You make one group really, really uncomfortable. In this case, like in like this really crude way possible, so that it sort of has to run out. And in this case, it lets black play another spoiling move against this group. So white plays here. Again, look at these four stones. Isn't it just dumb looking? It's really dumb looking. Dumb looking group of four stones. Four stones with two liberties, not a good idea. Right, why just make 10 points here almost instantly, right? Just, if this is Sentai at all, you know, we're just dead. Okay, but black does get a move. So, black plays there.
I don't know why black is still not taking the ko.
Because it's actually, if white takes, if as long as this group is not in trouble, and the ko is just fixed, there's no problem. If white takes that, black plays down there. Or even there. Oh, not that one, actually. That one. Yeah, it has to be that one. Yeah, if black plays this, this doesn't work.
Okay, I see.
But
I
right? Still dead group. So, White takes two stones, tries a few more little things. Oops, that's not there. So now, Black can take the Ko.
Yeah.
And so we're back to Ko, which is sort of what we thought earlier, but we thought White had a million Ko threats. But it turns out if you have two weak White groups, that's a very difficult tall order. White just plays this one, say, hey, can I make a second eye? No. No. Takes Ko. And if we look at the board, here, let's just do a little group analysis here. These four are dead, right? So all this White is super strong. Black corner is strong. This is all connected to White. Black can't run this out. So this is all strong. This is undetermined. So this Ko fight is actually going to spill in over here. This is strong-ish, but there might be a few Ko threats. But anyway, Rui Naue plays this move. Because even though this is strong, this makes it considerably less so. Right? If these four stones die, basically there's going to be another weak group, which nowhere to run to, right? It has to live locally. And, once Black does protect these stones in any way possible, this becomes direct Ko as well. So Li Changhao resigns here. He's looking at all these threats and going, I can't find enough threats to actually win a direct Ko fight for either of these groups. I should say both of them. He's both of them to win the game. The profit he took up here, was big, right? For such a small territory game, this looks huge, right? If everyone only has 30 points, this is a huge amount of territory. But it's not worth either of these. So, Rui Naue is one of the few Go players to actually have a winning record against Li Changhao. They've met a number of times. And she's actually beaten him. She's one of the few people to have beaten him more times than they've beaten the other person. A lot of people just attribute it to her style. Like Li Changhao, again, wants just everything settled, everything's cool, and then this is like these little knife fight kind of moves. And she doesn't like she likes these, much bigger sort of, let's play the middle, let's build up influence, let's attack on a really large scale kind of fights. And you kind of saw how she was able to find a way to do that, just by playing, this is almost like a Takamiya move, right? Over here. I think it was that one. She played another sort of Takamiya move here and here, just to get this group to safety. So, yeah, that's one of her games. Hey, Chris.
Time to get ready.
Yep. So what do you think?
Was there a way for White not to let his lower side be split into two groups?
Yes. Remember when White played here?
Yeah.
White could have just played a space below it.
Yeah.
White could have just done that. And then that would, no death, no problem. Why didn't he do that? Two reasons. Number one, all the potential in the middle is Black. So if the game continues this normally, and you play a slow second line move, and all of a sudden your opponent still has 20 points of potential in the middle, and like a 40-point to 40-point game, that's kind of unreasonable. Second, if you're in a really low scoring game, right, without any sort of huge moyos going on or huge territories, this is really tempting to take off the table, because not only does it take 12, 13, 14 points for you, it prevents all of this from becoming Black territory later on. And so Li Changhao, right, he's really, really good at reading, right? Really, really good, but occasionally he makes a mistake. And again, he would have had to more or less figure this out, this type of problem, when Black and first invaded, right? He'd have to read another 50, 60 moves after that to figure out, this is maybe not such a good idea to attack directly. And if he just connects underneath, maybe he was more scared of that, because, it's too easy for Black to amass too many points. So, yeah, Rui Naue, which I still don't pronounce well, but in the YouTube video for the people online, at least be able to read the literal English of it. And again, like I said, a lot of players still look up to her. She's not as strong as she once was, compared to the pros we have today. There are a number of other female players who've you know, sort of beaten her down a little bit, and she's no longer like top female dog. She's had a number of games with one of the pros that came to the ESCO Congress last year, Chao Yuyin, which I think we looked at a game of hers last year, I'm not sure, or right after the Go Congress, if you guys were in this class back then. Yeah.
Did you discuss, since I wasn't here earlier, that when she was in her prime of play, many pros thought she might be the strongest player in the world?
Oh, no. See, I didn't even know that, actually.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
She was here in the 80s with Jinjo.
I think it was early 90s she was in. You mean in the United States?
Well, she visited Seattle.
Oh, in Seattle, yeah.
Before
she moved. Okay.
And then there was a lot of discussion about that she, if she had been allowed to play.
Right. Oh, right, right.
The Japanese tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
Many people thought she would win.
She would beat them all.
Yeah.
She did beat Otake Hideki in one of their tournament games, who was a nine don, you know, very strong Japanese professional in the early 90s. So she, yeah.
Jujo certainly thought she was very powerful.
Well, she is. I mean, she beat Li Cheng Ho up and down the board numerous occasions. All right. You guys want to play some games?
Cool.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Nick.